I would like the Hello.
Yes, I'm here.
There we go, Dr. Giovanni Coco. Your camera is off.
Okay,
On the
I think okay.
Okay.
So
So I would like the while you are fixing your camera on the top left-hand corner of the screen, I would like to present Dr. Giovanni Coco. He is a consultant neurologist in MediClinic Parkview in Dubai, and he's going to talk to us today about how to approach patients with tremors.
okay, so from my point of view, I turn on the camera and I'm also sharing my monitor.
Okay.
Can you see what I'm seeing?
I can I see, yep, I see.
Okay,
Can
so
I turn off
what
my camera?
Dr. Giovanni, your camera seems to be black for some reason. Can you just try switching it off and on again?
There
There
we
we go.
go. There we go. Now
Thank
we
you very
see.
much. Okay,
Thank
so
you.
thank you very much, first of all, for inviting me to talk about how to approach a patient who presents with upper limb tremor. So I decided also to limit, not to talk about tremor in general, but how to approach specifically a patient who presents with upper limb tremor, because this is the most common way a patient presents in an outpatient clinic. So our focus would also be to give a definition of tremor and to identify and what are the clues which will help us to identify whether a tremor comes as an isolated syndrome or with a combined syndrome. So tremor is the most common movement disorder, which is encountered by neurologists, but it also commonly seen in general practice. So, very simply, a tremor can be defined as an involuntary, rhythmic, oscillatory movement of a body part. And it can take, as I said before, it can take place either isolatedly or it can be associated with other symptoms in a different clinical syndrome. So, when we describe a tremor and we are aiming to characterize it clinically, we should, of course, mention the age of onset, or, for example, it's also important to document the year of onset, because for some patients, we need to follow the map for the next year to confirm whether our preliminary diagnosis is indeed correct or not. Sometime, indeed, for example, you might have a patient with soft neurological sign and you needed to follow it up before giving a more definite diagnosis. We also needed to describe, to document the localization of a tremor, because, for example, in some patients, in some conditions, such as, for example, Parkinson's disease, typically there is a unilateral onset. We also needed to describe when the patient has a tremor, because some patients have a tremor typically at rest, but some patients have an action tremor, which can be observed only when the patient is performing some task. And so, finally, we also needed to check if there are accompanying signs together with a tremor, so if a tremor is isolated or combined. So it looks a bit complicated, but I think I used as a guidance a paper which has been published recently and which I have summarized with this flow chart. So the first thing that we needed to consider is the patient in front of us, the patient in front of us, has he really a tremor? For example, so in this video here, we can see a patient with some involuntary movement in his left lower limb. If you observe carefully, this left foot movement are somehow irregular, and they are not entirely rhythmic, so they can change. So this patient, for example, does not have a tremor, but he suffers from epilepsy apicalis continua. So basically, he has a constant focal motor seizure. He had the right MCA stroke, and some days later, he started to have these involuntary movements. So this is a patient, for example, who will certainly need imaging. Or, for example, we have here another patient, a young gentleman suffering from a condition called Arayama disease, in which you can see this irregular jerky movement, which can mistakenly taken as a tremor, but they are actually more consistent with a myoclonus. If indeed you treat it in a tremor, you can see this distal jerky movement involving individual fingers or both his hands. Something similar can also be seen in this patient suffering from multiple system atrophy, a Parkinsonian, an atypical Parkinsonism. So apart from the Parkinsonian feature, you can also see again a polymyoclonus, so not really a tremor, but this involuntary jerky movement of his fingers. So the other thing that we needed to look at is, are we dealing with a functional tremor? I am all sure you all know what I'm talking about when I mention a functional disorder, although the terminology might be different according to different backgrounds. For example, other used terms are a conversion motor disorder or a psychogenic motor disorder or dissociative motor disorder. So we must remind ourselves that at least 20% of the patients who attend the general neurology department will have a functional disorder, sometimes together associated with an organic disorder. So neurologists nowadays tend to use the term functional disorder, which is quite neutral. And if you allow me to use the term, it dissociates completely from the attempt to provide an etiology to the clinical phenomenon indicates. A functional disorder can be simply defined as a movement disorder which is significantly altered by disruption or non-physiological movement. For example, it can also have a dramatic placebo response, and which is clinically incongruent with movement disorder known to be secondary to a neurological cause. So, for example, in this video, we can see a patient with a right hand tremor, which is quite evident at rest. Initially, rather than a tremor, it looks more like a tapping movement. The technician is asked to keep her hands against the gravity. You might be tempted initially to define this as a dystonic tremor, considering the posture of the right hand, and there is possibly a tilting of towards the left of her head and of her neck. But then the patient is, and so you can see again, the patient is asked to keep her hands in against the gravity. And then she's asked to perform a different movement with the contralateral hand. And you can observe that the tremor can be disrupted, so it stops. Or you can also see an entrainment in which basically the frequency of the tremor on the affected side take the same frequency imposed by the examiner of the voluntary movement performed with the other limb. So when we can suspect a functional tremor, apart from their appearances, other things which can help is the variability in terms of amplitude, frequency, and features, an history of medically unexplained symptoms, and also the fact that some other member of the family can suffer with a movement disorder, such as, for example, a Parkinson's disease. So then we need to check if the tremor is comes isolatedly or if it is a combined tremor syndrome. For example, the most common movement disorder seen in clinical practice is essential tremor. And in this video, you can see a patient who has been suffering from essential tremor since her teenage. It is worth remembering that about 50% of the patients who suffer from essential tremor will have a positive family history. This tremor can show a quite variable degree of progression. It can remain relatively mild for some patients, but in some other patients, it can start to impact significantly on everyday life activity. So you can see that she has a tremor, which is absent at rest, but it can become quite evident when she's asked, for example, to write or to draw a spiral. It's generally present bilaterally, but some asymmetry is often seen. Generally, patients with essential tremor will not have a tremor in the lower limbs. So actually, this can be present in 20% of a patient. But if you see a tremor in the lower limbs, this should lead you to query the diagnosis of an essential tremor. So of course, it's important also to rule out when you have a patient with an isolated tremor to make sure that this is not secondary to some reversible cause. For example, renal failure or hyperthyroidism. And also, especially considering the age of a patient, if I have a patient who has the onset of a tremor below the age of 40, I would recommend, of course, to request some blood tests such as copper and ceruloplasmin to rule out Wilson disease, or an ophthalmological opinion to rule out Kaiser Fletcher rings, and also an MRI can help. So moving forward, we can now consider patients who suffer from a combined tremor syndrome. So the most common one is a patient who suffers from a tremor, which is one of the features of a Parkinsonism. So a Parkinsonism can be defined by the presence of bradykinesia in combination with at least one sign such as a tremor, rigidity, or postural abnormalities. So there are different Parkinsonian syndromes. So the most common one is going to be an idiopathic Parkinson's disease, but we also need to consider other causes of Parkinsonism. So the cardinal sign of a Parkinsonism is the presence of bradykinesia. So when we approach a patient with a tremor and we have the suspicion that this tremor could be a part of a Parkinsonian syndrome, we need to ask the patient to, for example, perform repetitive movement, for example, tapping their fingers, and observe a gradual decrease in the amplitude of the movement. Sometimes the patient might struggle for other conditions, for example, a rheumatoid arthritis, to move the fingers, and so you can ask the patient to perform other movements, such as opening and close the fist, for example. It's also important to check for the presence of, this is another movement, another task that you can ask the patient to perform in order to highlight the presence of bradykinesia. So, but when looking for the presence of a tremor, sometimes this tremor can be quite evident, as you can see on the video on the left, in which this patient as a rest tremor with a frequency of 4-6 hertz, and this tremor can be suppressed or can be reduced when asking the patient to perform a movement. A rest tremor, however, in some cases might not be entirely evident, and it might take some instance to appear, and you also need to make sure that the patient is fully relaxed, since often patient might be embarrassed by this clinical sign. So for example, on the right side, you can see again the same patient with Parkinson's disease, so you need to make sure indeed that the patient is fully relaxed. For example, you might make sure that the patient is not holding an object, or for example, the patient is not sitting on his legs to hide it. In some cases, it might be helpful to ask the patient, for example, to perform a cognitive task, such as, for example, taking away 7 from 100 consecutively, or asking, for example, to repeat the months of the years in backwards order. In some patients, apart from a rest tremor, you can also see what is called a postural tremor. And in patients with Parkinson's disease, this can take a while to appear. And so it's called a reemergent tremor. It can also be seen in a patient with essential tremor. You can also see an action kinetic tremor So when you check for this, it's important to make sure that the patient fully extends his arm and there is no change in the target position. You might want to change the position of the target if you are looking for a cerebellar tremor. And you also needed to make sure that you ask the patient to perform this test slowly. Otherwise, a subtle action tremor might be missed. So, and of course, in a patient in which you suspect a Parkinson's disease, you might also want to check for the presence of rigidity. Some resistance to passive movement can also be observed in other conditions, such as, for example, in stroke or MS. But in Parkinson's, the resistance to passive movement is independent from the speed with which the joint is mobilized. If no clear rigidity is observed, you can ask the patient to perform the front-end maneuver, the from-end maneuver. So, for example, in this case, the examiner has asked the patient to perform a different task with a contralateral limb to make the rigidity more evident. It's also important to check the pattern of distribution of rigidity in patients who present with a tremor, you suspect a Parkinson's disease. Because, for example, if you have a rigidity which is limited to the lower limbs, you might consider other conditions such as a vascular Parkinsonism, or, for example, in other atypical Parkinsonism such as PSP or MSA, the rigidity tend to be more axial. So another possible cause of a tremor is a cerebellar condition. So a cerebellar tremor is described as a tremor generally with a lower frequency, which tend to worsen as the patient approaches the target. So for example, when asking the patient on the left to perform an index nose test, other cerebellar signs, for example, such as a nystagmus, can be observed. And in this patient, since this patient has a bilateral cerebellar syndrome, you can see the nystagmus bilaterally. On the other video, we can see, for example, a patient, again with a cerebellar syndrome, in which there is some abnormality in the heel-shin test. And you can also see when he walks that he has a large based gait. I will speed it up. For example, when the patient is asked to stand up and walk, he tends to to have a large based gait. And when asked to perform, for example, a tandem gait, he struggles to perform this. So, of course, if a tremor is accompanied by this sign, of course, you rule out an essential tremor. So a tremor could also be seen associated with a dystonic disorder. So, dystonic tremor syndrome combines tremor and dystonia as the leading neurological sign. There are a lot of different syndromes which can be separated on clinical grounds. So dystonic posturing is the key feature of a dystonic tremor syndrome. It is now recognized that tremor is it's a very common feature of dystonia. It can happen up to 50% of the patient with an adult onset primary dystonia. A distinction can be made between a dystonic tremor in which the dystonia can be found in the affected limb. For example, a head tremor in a patient with a cervical dystonia, or a tremor associated with a dystonia in which the dystonia is found in another part of the body in which the tremor can be observed. So, for example, in this case, you can see this patient with a generalized dystonia, and you can also see this tremor in his upper limbs. The dystonic tremor can be postural or kinetic, but they can also happen at rest. So they tend to be like slightly irregular with a jerky aspect, And they can also be exacerbated by attempting to maintain a certain posture. On the video on the right, you can see a patient with a cervical dystonia with a tremor which is only which is affected her upper limbs. So you in this case the tremor is in this case the tremor is located in a different area. So you can see that she has a cervical dystonia, and something helpful to make this diagnosis could be, for example, applying a tactile stimuli in the affected area, which can determine a reduction of her dystonic posture and also of the tremor. So finally, we also need to remind ourselves that a tremor can also take place in association with a peripheral neuropathy. So in this video, you can see a patient who suffers from an inflammatory polyneuropathy, and you can see that she has a postural tremor. I think I can also... So she has an intention tremor. She has also a rest tremor with a slight myoclonic component. She has also a kinetic tremor. And she has also an ataxic dysarthria. So when of course we see a tremor associated with other sign, it's quite important in order to, of course, make an accurate diagnosis and to make sure we are not overlooking any other cause. And so the conclusion is to try to have a systematic approach when assessing a patient with tremor, having in mind the most common differential diagnosis, looking for the additional sign, and of course, when in doubt, refer to a neurologist. And thank you very much. I think I kept my time.
Dr. Giovanni.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the very educational and interesting lecture. The videos, I think, you can't give a tremors lecture without showing videos of tremors. So thank you very much. Highly educational.
Thank you.
So we have some questions, actually. The first question is from Muhammad Fathi Abdussalam. How can I differentiate essential tremors from cortical tremors?
From cortical tremor, you said?
Yes.
Okay. Well, generally, the fact that you can have, for example, essential tremor typically is a tremor which is quite regular. The fact that it tends to be absent at rest is something which can definitely help. The lack of associated other clinical sign is something which definitely can help. So other things which it's also important to remember that 50% of the patient might have a family history. There is also reported that essential tremor typically has a good response, for example, to alcohol, although alcohol can actually help in many other forms of tremor. So I think that the ruling looking for other signs, looking for other signs, other associated signs can definitely be helpful.
Very good. Thank you. Psychogenic tremors, how do you treat them?
Okay, so how I treat. First of all, I think it's quite important to explain the diagnosis of the patient. So having a positive approach. So not telling them you don't have a Parkinson's disease or you don't have essential tremor or you don't have a cerebellar tremor. So I think that having explaining to the patient the diagnosis is actually helpful. One of the things which I would avoid is to use the term psychogenic, because some patients may not take it easily, where because they will necessarily think that it's always related to a mental disorder. Now, it's true that many patients will have a psychiatric comorbidity, but some patients might not have any psychiatric comorbidity at all, and they still need to make a diagnosis. And they feel like a neutral approach, something which can help. So how do I, how do you deliver the message? I think is quite important. And also showing to the patient that you can suppress the tremor by doing some maneuvers. This is something which will help the patient to realize that the tremor has a functional origin. And the other thing is to give an explanation which the patient can understand. I often use the analogy of comparing our brain to a computer, so explaining to them that their problem is in the software rather than in the hardware. So it's a glitch which can be repaired, and it does certainly help to discuss with the patient the possibility of having a consultation with a psychiatrist to check if there is any comorbidity associated with that. Another approach is sending the patient for having a cognitive behavioral treatment input. In some patients with a functional disorder, or with a motor functional disorder, for example, physiotherapy can also help. And of course, self-help, such as, for example, techniques of relaxation or taking time for identifying the trigger or the factor which can exacerbate the tremor.
Thank you very much. Head imaging for essential tremors, do you do any?
I think that if I have a patient with a tremor, for example, below, for example, the age of 40, I will tend to, for example, request imaging. In other patients, for example, if I see some other sign, for example, if I have a patient who has a tremor and has a cerebellar sign, or does a, for example, sign of which might be suggestive for a normal pressure hydrocephalus, I will definitely would like to do imaging.
Thank you very much. Again, much appreciated. It was an extreme, a very educational lecture. And always looking forward to having you and seeing your videos. And we'll be seeing you in a bit. You'll be giving us another lecture later on about seizures and syncope.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.